Hello learners, NIOS welcomes you to painting subject video series. This is lesson number 11, Mauryan and Postmauryan Art, part 2. Now we will start discussing the background of the origin of Mauryan sculpture. First is the Gandhara art. This was during the Kushan dynasty. The Kushan dynasty thrived between the 1st to the 3rd century AD and included Pakistan as well as Afghanistan. This art form had a mix or a synthesis of Greek influence as well as Indian influence. This was depicted in the painting, in the art, in the sculpture. The Kushan dynasty had two important cities. One was Mathura and the second one is Peshawar. These two cities were the primary cities where sculpture, artwork developed and flourished at the same time. So they were contemporaries. Kushan dynasty king Kanishka was a patron of sculpture as well as architecture. The theme for the artwork was primarily Buddhism. Within the Kushana dynasty, Mathura became a very important center of art, and the special interest of the Mathura sculpture would be dynamic and scantily clad voluptuous female figures. And many such sculptures were found. Mathura became a very important center of art production. That means statues, figurines, sculptures, paintings were thriving in Mathura, and the themes importantly were Hindu, Buddhist and Jain sculptures due to the belief of the people during that empire. Then we have the Amaravati sculptures. This is located near Guntur in Andhra Pradesh. This place has a huge Buddhist stupa, and within the stupa there are lot of sculptures, mostly of Buddhist origin, and the majority of the development of the sculptures technically started in the 2nd century AD. As you saw, the Amaravati sculptures of Andhra Pradesh, this is one example of the Amaravati Buddha. You see the decoration, the various motifs, but the face is disfigured. Along with the sculptures of various places, we also have the Ajanta paintings. Ajanta paintings, you would remember the Gupta Empire, and within the Gupta Empire, there were cave paintings done in the caves of Maharashtra, and these belonged to three phases. This artwork, primarily found in cave 9 and cave 10, were the early paintings, and these were done in the 2nd century. Then the next phase were the images of Buddha on the pillars, and these were cave 9 and cave 10, which were done somewhere in the middle of the 3rd century. Then the last phase were paintings in the caves 1, cave 2, cave 16 and 17, and these paintings were done somewhere in the 5th century. Now, let us discuss about the first sculpture. The first sculpture is the Chanvardharini Yakshi. The medium is sandstone. The period is the Maurya period, somewhere in between the 3rd century BC. The size of this sculpture is 162.2 centimeters. This sculpture was found at a place called Didarganj, which is near Patna. The sculptor is unknown, and this sculpture is currently exhibited at the Patna Museum in Bihar. The general introduction for the Chanvardharini Yakshi. The Vedic tradition of the Hindus related to the Trinity of the Hindu pantheon believed that Yaksha or the earth spirits were venerated, and this continued and is also depicted in the statues and art. It was primarily venerated by the Brahmins, the Jains and Buddhist traditions. It was a kind of a belief system, and the Chanvardharini Yakshi is one representation of some kind of a myth. The Yakshi is a symbol of prosperity, as she is known as the guardian of nature, of forests, and she was venerated for a long life, longevity. You would see the sculpture, the anatomy is very stout, strong in terms of the physique and personality. And the traditional belief system was that voluptuous bodies like these were the traditional standards of beauty. And after the formulation of the figurine, it was highly polished to give that look. The Yakshi sculpture looks proud, strong and dignified woman. During the forming of the sculpture, the proportion has been totally taken care of very accurately. The features have been very realistically depicted. The face is sensitive. The breasts are heavy, the hips are broad, the waist is narrow, and the creases on the lower abdomen represent the traditional idea of the perfect feminine beauty. The size is 162.2 centimeters, and the Yakshi is holding a fan in her hand, a chanvar, which possibly could indicate that she was an attendant, is someone who takes care of the needs of a royal person. Whatever is requested, whatever is needed, the attendant is responsible and obliged. So the Chanvardharini probably was an attendant. The sculpture is shown wearing a headband, a choker, heavy earrings. You would see a very prominent choker also in the middle of the forehead, a very long necklace, bangles, as well as thick anklets. She is only clad in a mekhla, which is draped very elegantly with folds and pleats. Very exquisite artwork. This is the picture of red sandstone. Huge boulders and huge blocks were used, chiseled, sharpened, polished to ensure the realistic depiction, a proportionate depiction of these kind of forms, and red sandstone was used, same as is used in the Qutub Minar, is used for the depiction of this statue, this sculpture. Now let us discuss about the second sculpture. The title is Yakshi with a cage. Medium is red sandstone. The period of the sculpture is the 2nd century AD. The place of origin is Mathura, and the sculpture is exhibited at the National Museum in New Delhi. Yakshi with a cage, general description. The sculpture is made of red sandstone. Huge boulders of red sandstone are taken. It is a lot of work and fine skills to get the perfect shape. The Yakshi with a cage sculpture, the body of the Yakshi is voluptuous. This voluptuous body is the Indian ideal of the female beauty, which the artists also were able to aptly match. This Yakshi is standing in a Tribhanga posture. The leg has a separate angle, the waist and the head all have a kind of tilts. She is only wearing a mekhla, kind of a skirt, and the Yakshi with the cage stands on top of a Yaksha, that is a male, and the Yakshi is a female, and the Yaksha is on all fours, while the Yakshi stands on top of the Yaksha. That's how the sculpture is depicted. Now we will discuss the third sculpture. The third sculpture is the standing Buddha. The medium is grey sandstone. The period of this sculpture is the Gandhar period. Gandhar and the Kushan dynasty was ranged up till Afghanistan, Pakistan, as well as the northern India. This was done in the 2nd century. The size is 250 centimeters and it is exhibited now at the Miho Museum in Japan. Description of the standing Buddha. You will see a different kind of style, which is the influence of Greek art, and the hair or the curly hair, which also has a top knot, is a very different kind of a style in comparison to the other sculptures of Indian origin. This one had a Greek influence. The sculpture of Buddha here has long ears plus a nimbus behind his head, which is a symbol of an awakened person. The facial expression and features of Buddha is of benevolence, serenity, and peace. The Gandhar Buddha had a Greco-Roman connection. The anatomical balance is very special here. They have ensured that the description is realistically complete. The head is fully covered with hair, also has jewels and facial hair. The right hand is missing, which most probably was raised in the Abhaya Mudra. And this mudra meant no fear, confidence and strength, which possibly could be what this sculpture was originally depicting. The left arm is slightly bent, holding the garment in a royal kind of a posture. Before this, the standing Buddha is one kind of a depiction, but before this, the human form of the Buddha was never depicted. He was represented more by elephant, bull, the horse motifs, maybe the fact that Buddha was not depicted in a human form. There were also stupas which were built which symbolized Buddha. They were used for religious purposes. And umbrellas or the chhatras, which all of these were forms of depiction of Buddha. But before the standing Buddha, there was no human depiction of Buddha in a sculpture form. I hope you enjoyed watching part 2 of the lesson. If you have any queries, please email us at signlanguage@nios.ac.in. For more information, you may visit our website www.nios.ac.in. Thank you.